I am so glad to see each and every one of you here this morning. We are so glad that we got rain, right? Amen. We have some announcements in the bulletin that you need to read. I'm not going to read those to you, but I will say on Mike's behalf, choir practice today, so don't forget the choir practice. Brother Eric and Linda are honeymooning. And if you're on their Facebook page, you notice that they are doing some honeymooning, and we're thankful that they can. We take just a moment to welcome our Facebook friends, and hopefully our internet connection will last and it won't drop out and respool. And we also welcome our YouTube friends. Tom will, by nightfall tonight, have the service uploaded to YouTube, where you can watch it even if our bad internet service drops out. We do have a little hum on both of these. We're still trying to locate that hum. I think it's in the console itself, but we're working on that. But we're glad you're here. Take that deep breath now. Let's prepare to worship. As Lori brings our meditation, Lori. Scripture this morning is that familiar passage from Malachi 3:10, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough for it. Would you pray with me, please? Our Father, sometimes we think that we have nothing to give when the offering plate comes to us. Sometimes our checkbooks and our wallets are empty. Remind us again this morning that your first desire is the gift of ourselves. Remind us, O God, that when we give ourselves, we will discover treasures for the collection that we did not know we possessed. So today, inspire us, we pray, to give ourselves an offering to you in Jesus' name and for his kingdom on earth. Amen and amen. Brother Mike.
Little chorus we're going to sing this morning. Hymn number 71 was written by a man. He was born with no hands and no arms. And he wrote this song, and he takes his shoes off and plays the guitar barefooted as he sings this song. And so if anybody knows what it means to be lifted by eagle's wings, he does. So today as we stand together and sing this, we're going to sing it through twice and want to be reminded that God will lift us up if we just turn to him. And God will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you. 616, hymn number 616, Trust, Try, and Prove Me, singing all three stanzas. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, all your money, talents, time, and love. Consecrate them all upon the altar, while your Savior from above speaks sweetly, trust me, try me, prove me, says the Lord of hosts, and see if a blessing, blessing, I will not pour out on thee. When my wavering faith and trials falters, when his guiding hand I cannot see, then in wondrous love and tender mercy, through his word he says to me, my child, but trust me, try me, prove me, says the Lord of hosts, and see if a blessing, a measured blessing, I will not pour out on thee. I have yielded all my life forever. All I ever have or hope to be, not on earth my hold on him can sever. While I hear him say to be my child, just trust me, try me, the Lord of hosts, and see if a blessing, a measured blessing, I will not pour out on thee. Thank you. You may be seated.
Another man stood before you.
said, remember the time a missionary came to your church. His pictures made you cry. You didn't have much money, but you gave it anyway. And Jesus took the gift you gave. That's why I'm here today.
Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving.
For as the eye could see, each life somehow touched by your generosity. Little things that you had done, sacrifices made, I noticed on the earth, but in heaven now proclaimed. I know that up in heaven you're not supposed to cry, but I'm almost sure there were tears in your eyes. As Jesus took your hand, you stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you. Great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed.
Okay, boys and girls, it's our turn. Boys and girls, come on, 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 boys and girls. Yay, yay, yay. We got boys. Y'all not gonna sit up here? All right. One time a year, once a year, every year, we're missing somebody. We got to give him time to get his boots on. He's not gonna come. Okay. All right. He's gonna miss out on some money. Free money. Preacher's giving away free money. You better come get your free money. Come on. Once a year, y'all remember we did this once before since I've been here. You remember? Preacher gave away bags of money. Y'all remember? You wasn't here. You, Cassidy, you were too here, were you not? I thought you were. Oh, yeah, the paper money. This is real money. All right, so now you're here and we got the real money. I got it in bags. It's real money. Y'all want some real money? Now, you know, you got to help me this morning because you are helping me to teach the big folks back there. And what we're teaching them is God's principle about tithing. Y'all just heard that beautiful song that Brother Mike just sang about giving to the Lord, right? and the people that was in heaven because somebody gave. And so we teach all of our people, our big people, and to give. And we teach you when you're little, start learning now to give. So the Bible says that God gives us everything that we have. Everything that we have comes from God. Every good and perfect gift comes from God. And so whatever we give, whatever we get from God, God says that we're supposed to be stewards. That's a big old word. Can you say stewards? Stewards. Stewards. You know what that means? Sounds like a name, but it's not. Yeah. But what stewardship means is that when God gives us something, we have to take care of what God gives us. So when God gives you clothes, God expects you to take care of your clothes. And when God gives you shoes, God expects you to take care of your shoes. And when you get big enough and get that first car, God expects you to take care of the car. Because God says if you take care of what he gives you, he'll give you more. And so we always want to take care of what God gives us. That's called stewardship. And part of that stewardship is giving back to God part of what he gives to us. And God says that we should give him 10%. Now, you too little know 10%, but you too big, you know 10%. So you're doing math in school. So if I've got 100, how much is 10% of 100? 10. That's right. You got it, Cassidy. That's correct. So 10% of 100 is 10. That's right. And so if I give you 100 pennies, what's 1/10? No, 100 pennies is a dollar. It's a dime. It would be 10 pennies. If I gave you 100 pennies, 10% would be 10 pennies, right? So if I give you a dollar, then one dime of that dollar would be 10%. So God says, okay, here you go. There's a dollar. You get a dollar. You get a dollar. You get a dollar. Everybody gets a dollar. If I throw it, will he catch it? Take it to him. Take it to him, all right? Everybody gets a dollar. All right. Now, yeah, is 3/4, 2 dimes, and a nickel. That makes a dollar, right? So you're supposed to give God a dime back. You didn't get a nickel? Well, you got some dimes, right? But you got some dimes, right? You know what a dime is, right? You got a dime, right? So, everybody, here's the thing. If you want to keep your dollar, you have to give God a dime back. Can you do that? Cassidy, you're ready because she's done this before. All right, so Brother Digger's going to get the offering plate, and I'm taking up the offering, all right? So you got a dollar. So if you want to keep your dollar, put a dime in. You want to keep your dollar, put a dime in. Put a dime in. There you go. Now, let me tell a quick story to the church. Y'all big folks remember when I did this before. You going to bring me your dime? Give me your dime. That's a good boy. That's the way to go, kiddo. Yay! That's right. Now, let me tell the big folks a story. Y'all listen up, okay? Some of you were here when I did it. I do this once a year. I've been here over a year, so this is my second time. And so... So if you remember the story, if you don't remember, I'm going to remind you right now. This is the perfect teaching tool for a church. At my home church of Cushel Bethany Baptist Church, I had about 16 kids up here on the stage, and I did this thing, gave everybody a sack, you know, with 3/4, 2 dimes, and a nickel. And you want free money? Yeah, we want free money, right? Okay, you want to keep your dollar? Yeah, we want to keep our dollar. What you going to buy with it? And they all told me what they were going to spend it on. And then I said, okay, if you want to keep it, what you got to do, God says you got to give a dime back. That's 10%. So I got the offering plate, and I went around, and every one of those children gladly, like these children, dropped their dime in the offering plate, except one little boy. And when I walked up that little boy, he was sitting there, camera, I hope the camera can grab this. Tom, I hope you can grab this. That little boy was sitting there all scrunched down like this, and he had that little bag of money, and he had it so tight in his fist that, you know, his hands were red from squeezing that thing so tight. And he looked up at me with the biggest frown and the ugliest jaws, and he clamped those teeth down. He said, no! I mean, he shouted it. No, you can't have it. It's mine. You gave it to me. You're no Indian giver. I'm not giving you my dime. Okay, well, if you don't want to give me the dime, then give me the whole dollar back.
No, it's mine.
And just went back and forth until finally he relented, you know, and put his dime in, but he did not want to. What more perfect teaching tool did God give me than that teaching tool that morning to that house full of adults who many times act like that little boy? No, it's mine. I'm not going to give it, you know. And all God asks is 10 cents, and you get to keep 90 cents? I mean, hello? You know, God gives us all of that. And so my first sermon to y'all, unto whomsoever much is given, much is required. All of this fits together now. Yes, Miss Cassidy? Supposed to. You got more than that?
Yes, I
have. Ooh, look at there. God gave her extra with that. So what you going to do with that extra dime? You going to give it back? Well, I think God would appreciate that. You don't have to, but now, Cassidy, this is something. Put it in the plate. Now, this is what you're going to hear in the sermon this morning. The first dime was called tithe. The second dime is called offering. The Bible says, bring your tithes and offerings. So Cassidy has helped me this morning teach you about bringing tithes and offerings. Boys and girls, thank y'all so very much for helping me. Let's pray together. What do we do when we pray? Yeah, put it in. What do we do when we pray? You got it, kiddo. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Dear God, we pause to thank you for every good gift that you give to us, especially the monetary gifts that allows us to buy groceries and clothes and pay for our houses where we live and the cars that we drive. God, thank you for blessing us beyond our wildest comprehension. Thank you. And dear God, as we bring our tithes and offerings today, we pray that you will bless them in the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen. Thank you, boys and girls. Thank you, thank you. No, you can keep the bag.
I had a similar experience when I was growing up. Daddy gave us kids a quarter every Sunday to put an offering plate. And we had metal offering plates at Staple and Baptist Church, a little bit of felt in the bottom. I didn't want to give up my quarter. But Daddy insisted I give up my quarter, and so grudgingly, I not only put it in the plate, I threw it into the plate. And when it hit that metal, it rained. And when Daddy got me home, I rained. So after that, I was more generous about giving. Hymn number 604. Come all Christians, be committed. We're going to sing the first, second, and last stanza. If you're able, would you stand together with us? And Ben, would you come forward on that last stanza for our offering? Come all Christians, be committed. Hold it. I'm off. Let's try again. Give us an introduction. Come all Christians, be committed to the service of the Lord. Make your lives for Him more fitted. Tune your hearts with one accord. Come into His courts with gladness. Each His sacred vows renew. Turn away from sin and sadness. Be transformed with life anew. Of your time and talents give Him. They are from God above. To be used by Christians freely to proclaim His wondrous love. Come again to serve the Savior. Tithes and offerings with you bring. In your work with Him find favor, and with joy His praises sing. Men, would you come forward? Come in praise and adoration, all who on Christ's name believe. Worship, consecration, grace and love will you receive. For
24:1. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and all they that dwell therein. Would you pray with us, please? Our Heavenly Father, knowing who the owner of the earth really is, knowing who is truly Lord of all things, and who is Lord of all who live on this earth, we confess that we can only just now give unto you that which is yours already. Yet you have given to us the power and privilege to do so during this part of our worship hour. Thus we thank you and now offer to you what is rightfully yours in faith and in joy and with a willing heart. And we offer both this prayer and these offerings in the name of him who said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen and amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Thank you so very much, Lori. Fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Oh, have you ever in the quiet time, in your Bible study, in quiet time with God, you ever just sang that song, recorded to the Lord? Here's my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Yeah. Thank you so very much for that. Thank you, Amy, for getting well and being back with us today. We missed you, lady. We missed you terribly. This preacher misses you when you're not here. And I'm so glad that all of you are here. Take your Bibles today and turn way back in the Old Testament, if you would please, to the book of Exodus, chapter 35 and 36. The book of Exodus, chapter 35, chapter 34 and 35, 35 and 36. Find Exodus 35. And put your bulletin there, or your finger there, or your somebody's finger there, and hold it, because I'm going to come back and read. You're going to read with me very, very shortly from this Old Testament story. This is my annual stewardship message. So annual stewardship. And I've been with you over a year now. I'm in my second year, so I get to do it twice. This is my second time. Got to or get to? Are you a got-to Christian or a get-to Christian? Is this a got-to church or a get-to church? All right. I began as your interim pastor July the 4th, 2021. I've been with you 15 months. This church formed a pastor search committee who has done a very good job, in my opinion, and I do believe that they've got to search and narrow down to one person. The committee is working with that person under the leadership of the Holy Spirit to see if this is the man that God has prepared to be your next pastor. And this morning, I'm going to do your next pastor, whoever he might be, I'm going to do your next pastor a huge favor. I don't know him yet. He doesn't know me yet. But I know he will most certainly appreciate this favor I'm going to do for him this morning. I'm going to preach about money so he doesn't have to. Right now, some of you here and some of you watching by Facebook or watch this later on YouTube, right now somebody's going to say, that's going to turn everybody off. Hey, yeah, that's all you Baptists ever talk about is money, 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 money. Well, it's not all I ever talk about, but I'm going to talk about it this morning. I hate to preach about money. I hate it with a purple passion. I do not like to preach about money. I just feel like when you give your life to God and you read the book, you understand what I told the kids this morning. Everything belongs to God. Everything we got comes from Him according to the Word. Every good and perfect gift comes from the Father. The Father of lights comes from above. We have nothing. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. I read for our offertory scripture this morning. So I'm going to preach about money no matter how bad I hate it. And if your new pastor is anything like me and all the other preacher buddies that I know, we all hate to talk about money. I just feel like when you get saved and baptized, your pocketbook gets baptized too. And I believe you're going to be obedient and obey the laws of God, the commands of God, and that includes giving the tithe and the offering. So, okay, now let me get on with this got to or get to business. By the way, I got that term from my buddy Chuck Poole and the idea for this sermon from him. I'm not preaching his sermon, I'm preaching mine, but I got the idea from him. As a small boy, I remember telling my mama that I was tired of living a got-to life. I wanted to begin living a get-to life. Now, y'all all know what I'm talking about. Digger, you got to cut the grass. Digger, you got to do your homework. Digger, you got to clean your room. You got to help your daddy wire that house this Saturday morning. You got to hoe the garden. Digger, you got to feed those rabbits. And Digger, you got to clean their cages. Mama, I'm tired of got to. I want to get some get to. I wanted to get to swimming at Johnson's Lake. I wanted to get to go fishing with my Uncle Chip Hanna. I wanted to get to go to the Dew Drive-In Theater with all my friends. I wanted to get to do some of the things that I wanted to do. but my got-to list was longer than my get-to list. I kept being told by my mama and my daddy, if you just get through what you got-to list, you'll get to your get-to list. But my got-to list was long. And somehow or other, I never finished the got-to list. Well, boy, as soon as you finish hoeing that row, you can get... No, when I finished that row, then it was time to got to do something else. This got-to life, I really got tired of that got-to business. It was long. Chores of many. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Every one of y'all. Y'all had a got-to mama and a got-to daddy just like I did. I know you did. And you know what I'm talking about, all right. Some of y'all woke up this morning and you said, well, I guess I got to get dressed up and go to church. But some of you woke up this morning just like I did and said, well, I thought Sunday would never get here. But here it is, and I get to go to church this morning. I get to visit with my friends. I get to study the Word of God. It's a get-to morning for me. Are you a got-to Christian or a get-to Christian? What about work? Tomorrow morning, will you wake up and say, well, I got to get up and go to work this morning. I know you kids are hungry and you need clothes. I got to do this. Wasn't for all you kids, I wouldn't have to do that. Mumble, grumble, no. Some of you are like me. Man, I can't hardly wait to get to work this morning. I wonder what God will send my way today. And He does every single day. Now, you know, our stewardship is a whole lot like that. Some people feel like they got to give. Some folks feel like they get to give. The scriptures that we're going to read introduce us to a whole bunch of God's people who were get-to people. And I want to read a few verses about them with you. So Exodus chapter 35, if you've got your Bibles open to Exodus 35. Now let me set the scene for you. Let me get you in the context. The nation of Israel has just spent 450 years as slaves in Egypt. All of you who are Christians remember that story. God brought them out of Egypt with a mighty hand. You remember Moses and Aaron going down and all the miracles God did, turning the water into blood, turning frogs everywhere. You remember all the plagues that Pharaoh had to endure. And then that last plague was where the firstborn son of every human being in Egypt, plus the firstborn animal, male of every animal in Egypt, died. Y'all remember when the death angel came through. But none of the Hebrew firstborn males died. None of their firstborn animals died. And Pharaoh said, get out of here. I'm tired of you bunch of folks. And they got out of there. But as they were leaving to get out of there, God prompted the Egyptians. And the Egyptians said, yeah, well, we want to find favor with you, God. So here, take this bag of gold. Here, take this silver. Here, take this roll of cloth. Here, take. And the Bible says that they, what's that word they use? I don't remember that word. But anyway, the word means that they plundered. That was the word. They plundered the people of Egypt. And Egypt just loaded them up with all kind of good stuff, right? Now they're off to go to the promised land, and they're wandering around, and it's time to build a tabernacle, a movable tent, the church of God. The people of God need a place of worship. And so God gave Moses directions on how to build a tabernacle, a movable church building, because they were going to be wandering around for a few years over there before they get to the promised land. And so God gives instructions. Now this is the context, and so let me pick up the story at verse 4 in chapter 35. Moses said to the whole Israelite community, this is what the Lord has commanded. Verse 5, from what you have. Now what did they have? They got all that plunder from Egypt. All that stuff, they're loaded up. From what you have, take an offering for the Lord. Now, if you have not underlined this next sentence in your Bible, I hope that you do. I have it underlined in mine. Everyone who is willing, that's the part you want to underline. Everyone who is willing is to bring to the Lord an offering of gold, silver, and bronze. Wait a minute. Everyone who is willing? What about those who are unwilling? Like that little boy at my home church who said, no, it's mine. I don't know what God did with those who were not willing, but it appears that everyone was willing because they just spent 450 years in slavery. And God's rescued them with a mighty hand with many miracles. So apparently they were all willing. So anyway, everyone who is willing is to bring to the Lord an offering of gold, silver, bronze, blue, purple, and scarlet yarn, fine linen, goat hair, ram skins, dyed red, hides of the sea cows, and on the list goes. Look at verse 10. All who are skilled among you are to come and make everything the Lord has commanded. The tabernacle with its tent and its covering. And it goes on to describe all of that. I'm old. Some of you are old. I remember as a young boy at Myers Memorial Baptist Church in 8 Mile, we got up on Saturday and went up there. We're going to build us a brand new church building. So the plumbers came and the carpenters came and my dad, the electrician, came and we built the building that we were going to worship in. That's how we did it in the old days. That's how they was doing it back then. Verse 20. Skip down to verse 20. Then the whole Israelite community withdrew from Moses' presence. Verse 21, and everyone who was willing and whose heart moved him came and brought an offering to the Lord for the work on the tent of meeting, for all its service, and for the sacred garments. Verse 22, all who were willing, men and women alike, came and brought gold, jewelry of all kinds, brooches, earrings, rings, ornaments. They all presented their gold as a wave offering, an offering to the Lord. Do you pick up on these words? I'm not going to read the whole text to you, but that offering is listed in verse 23 twice, going down to verse 25. Every skilled woman spun with her hands and brought what she had spun, blue, purple, or scarlet yarn, or fine linen. Verse 26. And all the women who were willing and who had the skill spun the goat hair, and on it goes. Verse 29, all the Israelite men and women who were willing brought to the Lord freewill offerings for the work the Lord through Moses had commanded them to do. They got busy building this tabernacle. Skip down with me, verse 36. When you get home today, you can go back and reread these chapters in their entirety. Right now, skip down to chapter 36 with me, verse 2. Then Moses summoned Bezalel and Oholiab and every skilled person to whom the Lord had given ability and who was willing to come and do the work. They received from Moses all the offerings the Israelites had brought to carry out the work of constructing the sanctuary. And the people continued to bring freewill offerings morning after morning. Verse 4, so all the skilled craftsmen who were doing all the work on the sanctuary left their work and said to Moses, look at this, if you didn't underline this, you need to underline this. They said to Moses, I'm in verse 5 of chapter 36, the people are bringing more than enough for doing the work the Lord commanded to be done. Verse 6, then Moses gave an order, and they sent this word throughout the camp. No man or woman is to make anything else as an offering for the sanctuary. And so the people were restrained from bringing more because what they already had was more than enough to do all the work. What a story. What a story. Seems to me that the folks in our Exodus story saw passing the offering plate not as something they had to do, but it's something they got to do. These folks did not ask, how much have we got to give? But they asked, how much do we get to give? You see, again, God had just delivered them from 450 years of slavery. They had seen the miracles of God performed. Even on their journey in the wilderness, they saw miracle after miracle. And I've already reminded you that on the night they left Egypt, they hit the jackpot. They really hit the jackpot. They were rich. So let me pause and ask a question. When did God deliver you from the slavery to sin? When did God gift you with total forgiveness of your sins? When did God gift you with eternal life in His presence forever and forever? Let me remind each one of us, you and I, we have hit the spiritual jackpot, don't you think? How much have you been given? Unto whomsoever much is given, much is required. You can be like a little boy at my home church and grab a hold to it and say, no, it's mine, it's mine. Or you can be like these children this morning and gladly give up the 10% and the offering, the tithe and the offering. Now, here we are this morning at Union Baptist Church, where the finance committee, the budget committee, is meeting with all the other committees of the church through the church council, and everybody prays about what it is that God wants this church to do in the coming year and what that will cost. And you should know that that process is going on as I speak. That process is going on right now in Union Church. The finance committee, the budget committee, is meeting with all the other committees and asking for them to present their budgets. What has God told you that he wants you to do? Helen, what are you going to do with the children this coming year? How much is it going to cost? Mike, how much are you going to need for the music for the church in the coming year? What's it going to cost? Every committee is being asked that, and the budget finance committee is assimilating all of those costs. And then when all the committees have received a word from God about their respective ministries, they will tell the finance, the budget committee. And when the finance slash budget committee adds up all the money that the committees will need to do their work that God has asked them to do, and then the finance slash budget committee tells the church council, and the church council tells the church, and then the church says, what? That's more than we did last year. You up in the budget how much? And then that magic question comes, that infamous question comes up. How are you going to pay for all that? And Brother Digger says, I'm asking all Union Baptist Church members and all the friends of Union Baptist Church who have willing hearts to be faithful in their tithes and offerings. Very, very soon, my work with you will be done. You will have a brand new pastor to lead you into the future. The finance committee and the pastor search committee are currently, right now, working on a compensation package for the new pastor. How are you going to pay for that? Everyone who has a willing heart. Under your new pastor's leadership, Union Baptist Church will, underline will, capitalize will, highlight the word will. Under your new pastor, Union Baptist Church will soon have youth in this church once again. And the youth leaders will want to have pizza parties for them so they can invite their friends to come and hear how much God loves them. And the youth leaders will want to take them to summer camp. I hope it's Centrifuge or Missionfuge or something equally as good. How are you going to pay for that? Everyone who has a willing heart. Union Baptist Church will. Do you hear me? Do you hear God? Union Baptist Church will once again have children in this church. And Helen will want to take them to GA camp and other places where they will learn how much God loves them. And Helen will want to have outreach events with all those jumpy doohickey things that the kids love. And Helen will want to get the hayride and the train ride back up here to attract new children and their parents. Because if the kids come, their parents will come to this church. And we need to put a fence around our playground out back to keep those young children from wandering down by the creek where they could be snake bit. You know what fence costs? It's about $30 a lineal foot. How are you going to pay for all that? And VBS, Brother Digger, don't forget it for the children. VBS, Vacation Bible School. We got to have Vacation Bible School. Because as the twig is bent, so grows the tree. And when those young children come to this church, and their lives and spirits are bent toward the Son of God, they will grow straight and tall for his kingdom. But if you allow them to get out into the world where Satan crooks them over and breaks their back, I'm not even going to go there. As the twig is bent, so grows the tree. So we got to have vacation Bible school and all this other. How are you going to pay for all that? Everyone who has a willing heart, hear me, please, hear God. Union Baptist Church will have young couples in this church once again. And I pray that your new pastor will have the wisdom to bring in trained persons to offer marriage enrichment seminars, not only to our young couples, but to all the young married couples in our community. And I hope your new pastor has the wisdom to hold financial education classes and maybe teach Dave Ramsey's wisdom to this new crop of folks in our community. So they can learn that everything they get comes from God, and they should budget, and they should learn, and they should not be in debt, and they should, everything Dave Ramsey says, I say amen. Continue this tradition of Union Baptist Church being relevant to this community. Continue, I say, this tradition of scattering joy since 1868. And all of this is going to cost how much, Brother Digger? And the eyeballs go up and the eyebrows go up and the hearts go to pounding. This is going to cost how much? It doesn't matter how much it's going to cost. God will provide. Jehovah Jireh, God will provide. That's the name of God who is the provider. That's where God was named when Abraham offered Isaac. Jehovah Jireh, God will provide. Everyone who has a willing heart. And when the new pastor comes, how are you going to pay for his salary and reimburse his mileage and his medical insurance and retirement plan and still pay for the other staff and utilities and insurance for the church? How are you going to pay for all that? Everyone who has a willing heart. And the Buildings and Grounds Committee has developed a list, a long list. We have developed a long list of delayed maintenance items that need to be done. How are you going to pay for all of that? Do you understand how much the light bill is for this church every month? Yeah, all of you do. You respond, yes. We know what it costs to keep the lights on and power on, and we get to have a part in that. We don't got to. We get to have a part in keeping the lights on in this church and the heat and the AC on in the nursery where our babies first hear, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. And that's the little song that brought this boy back to God when I was prodigal in the slop hog pen way out yonder all those years ago. I remembered because the Holy Spirit brought that little song back to me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. We get to have a part in keeping the lights on in every Sunday school class where the Bible is taught and people learn how to draw close to Jesus. We get to have a part in shaping the lives of children. As the twig is bent, so grows the tree. We get to have a place for the youth of this community to meet in this house of the Lord where they learn how much God loves them instead of them meeting down at the parking lot of the shopping centers where the drugs and alcohol flow freely. We get to provide the means for our minister of music to lead us in quality music as we worship the Lord in music. We will once again get to sponsor a youth for camp and shape that life for Jesus. But how are you going to pay for all that? Please hear me, church. The Finance/Budget Committee and the Church Council will say, we are going to ask the faithful folks of Union Baptist Church who are of a willing heart to bring their tithes and their offerings. just like Moses asked the children of Israel in this Exodus story that we've just read from. And the good folks of Union Baptist Church will say, you mean we get to? We get to give our tithes and offerings to build God's church, and they will bring so much that the finance/budget committee will have to say, preacher, the people are bringing much more than enough for doing the work the Lord's asked us to do this year, and you'll have to tell them to stop bringing it. Let me show you something right now. Your interim preacher will never ask you to do something that he himself is not willing to do. Your preacher, whether an interim or your full-time pastor, should lead by example. I am not trying to gather any backpats from anybody, so don't the first one of you go there, but I do want you to know that every time I find a check in the pastor's box over there, I write a check back to the church for 10% of whatever that check is before my taxes come out, and then I go home and write the same amount of check to my VOA, because that's my church family back over at Volunteers of America. And every pastor who's here and every member of this church should bring their tithes to the church. And I want you to know, and again, I am not up here looking for any kind of backpack pattern. Don't you dare go there with me. But let me tell you what, when it's time for offering, for example, when we ask Tom and Mary to put together that church directory, so and ask you to get your pictures taken, which some of y'all hadn't got your pictures taken, I'm going to haunt you if you don't get your picture taken. Because the new pastor, when he gets here, he's got to learn 100 folks. You've only got to learn one. And that new directory will help him put a face with a name and an address and a phone number. So when we were printing that and we wanted to take an offering to help print for it, your preacher, your interim preacher, put up his $100 with some other folks who put up their $100. I'm not boasting or bragging in any way, shape, or form. I'm telling you, I get to give to the work of the Lord. And so do you. And you have and you do. And I love you and I'm thankful to God that you do. I just want you to know that this preacher and your next preacher, whoever he is, should do the same. There was a church in West Mobile where the pastor preached on tithing a whole lot, but he himself did not tithe. And when it came time for the church secretaries, it was a big church, to start sending out all the giving record for the year, his name wasn't on there because he didn't give the first dollar. By the way, if you're a member of this church or if you've given to this church, you should have just received in the mail last week or the last 2 weeks the record of your contributions. I have asked I've asked Norma and the secretary of the church each quarter, four times a year, not once a year, four times a year, to send out the tithing record so that if I have missed one, I can make it up. And if you have missed one, you can make it up. You know where you stand on your tithes and offerings. And so four times a year, you're reminded, bring you all the tithes into the storehouse. That's the biblical command from God. That's why you're getting it four times a year instead of one time a year, because statistics show that the churches who send out the tithing record four times a year, their income increases instead of decreasing like some other churches that only send it out one time a year. We're not trying to browbeat. We're not trying to gouge. We're just trying to remind you, do what God asks you to do. I mean, what more can somebody ask? Anyway, your preacher does not do anything he doesn't ask you to do. I learned that when I was in the Army. When I went to basic training my first week there, and that first sergeant took all of us back into the latrine, that's a men's room for you ladies, he took us back in the latrine, and he rolled up his sleeves and showed us how to scrub a toilet and how to scrub a urinal and how to mop the floor. He himself did that. And he said, understand, I won't ask you to do something I'm not willing to do, but tomorrow morning it's your turn. This is how you do it. So I want to lead by example. Every good leader leads by example. And also remember that the first check, that check I just put in there, that's my tithe. That other $100 check, that was my offering. I want to be a get-to preacher, not a got-to preacher. And I want to have a church that's full of get to people, not got to people. So, and I know, let me smile real big now. Listen to me. You are Union Baptist Church is, you are a get-to congregation. You really are not a got-to congregation. I love that about you. How many people have been baptized over the years by Union Baptist Church? 168 years? Is it 168 years? Well, I'm close. It's 100 and some odd years and a bunch of years. How many people came to know the Lord, joined the kingdom of God, baptized in Union Baptist Church? How many preachers came from this church? How many missionaries came from this church? How many Christian people who shape our world every single day came through this church? You remember our recent homecoming a couple weeks ago? Rusty Roberts came out here from the University of Mobile. You remember how Pam read that story when the Mobile College was just a thought in some people's minds, and Mobile Baptist Association got together and it got a committee going, and all the churches said, yeah, that's a good idea. We'll help support that. And so each church was assigned a number that if you gave this amount of money, it could happen. And if you didn't give, it wouldn't happen. And Union Baptist Church was assigned $3,000 and some odd. And at that time, Union Baptist Church was in the red, wasn't paying its bills. And the current pastor, I don't remember the name, Pam can tell you, you can read it on our line. It's on our webpage, the history. You can read where the pastor at that time said to the church, if you'll just be faithful in your tithes and offerings, God will provide, and we can do the $3,000. And the people of Union Baptist Church, because you are and you were and you will be get-to people, you were faithful in your tithes and offerings, and not only did the church get back in the black, but you raised over $10,000 to start the University of Mobile. See, when you're faithful, God is faithful. When this church got faithful with its tithes and offerings, it got out of the red and got in the black. And got in the black enough to take up for $10,000 to give for that worthy cause. How many college students? Rusty told us how many foreign students were at the University of Mobile being exposed to the gospel of Jesus Christ every day. How many people? I'm one of those people who graduated University of Mobile. Some of you went to the University of Mobile. And the University of Mobile turns out nurses and doctors and accountants and English teachers and school teachers, and they all go into our world as Christian people dedicated to the kingdom of God. That's the influence this church has had on our world and on the kingdom of God, because you are a get-to people. And you, every one of you who have and who do faithfully bring your tithes and offerings, share in the ministries of all these people who've gone before through this church. The Apostle Paul said in Philippians 4:17, and this is the verse that I always use in my thank you notes. The Apostle Paul said when he wrote to the church, not that I desire a gift, but I desire fruit that may abound to your account. And every preacher ought to feel that way. I'm not coming here to look for a paycheck. I'm coming here to hopefully do something that will bring somebody to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. And whenever we all get to heaven, that song that Mike sang a few moments ago will become reality. And God and somebody will say, thank you for giving to the Lord. I am the one who was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. Not that I desire a gift, but I desire fruit that may abound to your account. And so, God, if you remain faithful in your tithes and offerings, God will walk up to you individually, personally, and corporately as a church, and God will say, him. And if you hadn't heard my him sermon, go to YouTube and find it and listen to it. Him. Individually and corporately, and God will be honored, and many souls will be added to the kingdom of God. You are a get-to people. You will get to bring your tithes and offerings to fund this new budget that will be presented to you very soon, and to pay for your new preacher who will be here hopefully very soon. And all of God's people said, and that's right. Pray with me, please. Father, thank you for blessing us the way you've blessed us. Even the poorest among us has a house to live in. We have food before us every day. We have clothes on our back and shoes on our feet. And we live in a country where we have freedoms unparalleled in the history of the world. Thank you, O God, for blessing us the way that you have. We pray that you will continue to bless each and every member of this church as they get to be a part of your kingdom. Honor your word, O God, and open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing that they never even imagined. This is our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. We will have an invitation. Three parts to the invitation. If you've never freely given your heart and life to Jesus Christ and made him Lord of your life, you need to do that right now. You might be a church member already. You may have been baptized already. But if he is not Lord of your life, you need to make him Lord right now. And if you have, but you've been off in the briar patch somewhere doing stuff you ain't supposed to do, come on back home. If you're a prodigal, come on home. I'm tired of sin and wondering, Lord, now I'm coming home, the songwriter said. Or if you're just looking for a good church where you can put your membership and use the spiritual gifts that God's given to you, this is the place. You have found the place. That's our invitation to you as we sing. Would you please stand with us and sing number 275. Sunday morning, immediately following our worship service, there will be a special call church business meeting where we will vote to approve deacon for the new deacon year. So please, all of you who are members, remember that and be present next Sunday for that vote. Okay? And now, may the love of Almighty God and may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and may the fellowship of his Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you now and forever. And all of God's people said,
Amen.
And
Amen.